test of sorts to see if I can do video tutorials or not, like real ones. People have been asking me to do this for quite a while, and I don't want to say I brushed them off, but I don't know a whole lot about video editing, and I didn't have a microphone, so it was kind of like a I dragged my feet getting to this point, I'll admit. But this channel has over 1,000 subscribers, which is totally crazy to me. But it indicates that, there's some interest in this hand painted stuff, and perhaps there's not enough other people out there explaining how to go about doing it. I don't know. But yeah, I'm gonna, paint this and talk a bit about it. If that sounds like it's of interest to you, maybe this video will help you, maybe it won't. I don't know. But either way, I think I'm gonna get started. Okay. To save some time, I just went ahead and modeled this in advance. It's so simple, I didn't really figure it was worth showing. The way I did the UVs is not how I normally would do it, but what it'll do is make me only, or allow me to only have to paint one side, and it'll just kind of repeat it around. Rather than, I didn't see any reason to, paint multiple sides of this thing, since they're going to be so similar anyway. I'm using the Google Summer of Code Paint branch, which you can find builds on graphicall.org. Most of the features are planning to be merged around 2.72. So if you're watching a video, in the future, watching this video in the future, and you have a build after that, you should have these features. One of them that it has is if you don't have a texture on your model and you go into texture paint mode, it'll automatically set one up for you. So even if this is like the default cube without UVs, I could just go into texture paint mode and start painting on it, and it'll work, which is really nice. And that's managed over here in this Layers tab. Like if I had multiple materials and textures or stuff, all that stuff would be listed in here, and then you can select between them so you know which one you're painting on, rather than, the old way where you have to tab in and out of edit mode. And as you can see, you can add more textures through here too, which will automate rather than, manually doing it with all these settings. So that saves a lot of time. It's not perfect. I noticed that like this did not update. If I select this, it will. But even then, I can't see the UVs, so I still have to, do the old-fashioned way where I tab into edit mode and pick a texture and come back out. You can see the now I have the UVs over here. So maybe some of that stuff will be fixed. I don't know. I don't know how complicated that is. Another thing you might have noticed is these new brush icons up here. The presets are actually exactly the same, at least in this build. I'm not sure if there's any plans to change these or not. I don't find these very good for painting. If I just do a stroke, you can see that this edge is pretty blurry, which is not very ideal if you're wanting to do sharp detail. But on the other hand, it's really prone to stepping. You can blend with it, but just not very easily. It's just somewhere in between not being very useful either way. So I find that when I'm using these default presets that I have to fiddle with this curve a lot, which I don't like to do when I'm painting. When I'm actually painting, I just like to think about painting, light, shadow, color. I don't like to think about brush settings. There are these presets down here which are okay, but I think they seem to be more calibrated for sculpting maybe. Like if I do this max as no fall off at all, it should give me a very crisp edge, which it does. But it's pixelated. And to be fair, this is because it doesn't have anti-aliasing. It's not really the curve's fault. Either way, not very good for painting. So what I usually do is I just make a couple of my own beforehand. I have an entire set, but Blender has this fake user data block system that makes it really complicated to get brushes in and out of Blender, and it saves with the file. Then you have to go and delete the other ones that aren't very useful, which means you have to unflag it, delete, restart Blender. It's a really big mess. I could make an entire tutorial just on this data block system. It's so confusing. So instead, what I usually do is I just, take these presets and then just overwrite them with settings that I do like. It only takes a few seconds once you're used to it anyway. The way the curve works is the left side is the center of the brush and the right side is the outer edge. So you're just right now I have like a max brush setting. These are, it's completely opaque pixels all the way across, which gives me this stroke that I just talked about that has the pixelated edges that I don't like. To fix those, all you have to do is just add a fall off. So something like that. And again, this is center, totally opaque pixels, just right at the end, we're just kind of blurring it out. And that'll give a stroke that is like that, where it's still a hard edge, but it's a lot cleaner. And the other brush that I want is totally the opposite, where it's completely soft. And to get that, I just start with this diagonal and go all the way down where it's almost transparent and just has a fall off. And it'll give a brush that's, you can just build up and get nice smooth transitions. I'm actually using a mouse right now. When I switch to a tablet, this is even easier to do. Another thing to be aware of with the presets is that the color picker is actually not a global setting, it's per preset. Each preset will have its own color. So if I select red on the soft brush and then switch to hard, you can see that it's not red anymore, it's white. That's what I had last selected. This can be tedious sometimes, I find, when painting, because I will be painting something, and then I want, a darker value maybe. So I select it on the color picker, but then I want a smoother transition, and I switch brushes, and I don't have, I mean, it's still there, but it's on the other brush. I have to reconfigure this brush to have that same color, which can be annoying. Sometimes you can color pick your way out of it, just color pick a thing and then reselect it, but other times it's just, you just kind of got to deal with it. I don't know if there's any plans to change that or not. Just something to be aware of. The last preset that I'm going to set up is just a fill, which is actually a new tool for this branch. There's also masking, which works like sculpt mode. I'm not going to demo that in this video. Maybe, future, if maybe I'll make a tutorial on it in the future. I am going to use fill. It's pretty simple. It's just a flood fill. And I'm going to just use it to set up kind of a base color. Kind of from a blue down to like a purple. I want like a cool brick look for most of this. So something around there. And just to make sure that the whole thing gets filled, I turn off occlude, colon, normal. And to use gradient is easy enough. You just click and drag. And it is based on your, it's a projection. Notice that it's not getting this top piece. I don't know. I don't know why it gets these, but not that. Maybe the angles on these is a little off. Another feature of fill is if you go into paint mode in the UV image editor, there is an additional option for fill threshold. By default, it's zero and it's only going to fill one little pixel. The higher up this goes, the more colors it'll bleed into. So if I just do like a 0.010, it's going to fill in all this black. So like that, it's a fill tool. About every image editor has something like that. Let's see. Before I forget, I want to turn these back on. And the other thing I wanted to do is change the top piece and the bottom piece more to a warmer gray, like a different material than what the middle part bricks are going to be. So to do that, I'm just going to switch to a hard brush, change it to color blending mode and with the color I want. And then I'm just going to paint it over in here. And with the color blending mode, it's going to keep the values the same, but just adjust the hue on those pixels to get something like that. Since these are going to be the same material, I don't want this to get quite that dark. I want a little bit of a fall off, but that almost looks like it would be the material itself is interacting with light a bit different. So I want to brighten this. this up just a little bit, and I'm just going to use a mix with that. I still want it a little bit darker than the other one for the fall off, but you know, I want them to look like it's the same kind of material, just under a bit different lighting conditions. So to kind of color more efficiently, what I try to do is work on the whole model at once. It's just an old painting rule. You don't want to get caught up in detail too early on, or you're probably going to run into problems. I just try to work the whole thing at once and just kind of refine the detail all at the same time. I just find it a little bit more efficient. It's a pretty common workflow. It's not always easy to do in Blender. Like, if you have a complicated model, you have to switch between things because you can't paint on more than one object at a time, but it's usually the best to try to do it that way. That looks like it should be a bit brighter than that. Let's see. You can see that there's a face pointing almost straight up. If light was coming down, it would catch quite a bit of light. And on the other hand, underneath these, there should be more shadow. So I find it better just to block in big stuff like that first, which is what I'm going to do here. I think that's a bit too bright. Let's tone that back a bit. And I'm not going to be perfect. This is going to be a really beat up thing by the time I'm done detailing it anyway, so no reason to try to get perfectly straight lines. I think I'm going to make this a little bit cooler underneath. That looks a little better. I think that needs to be a bit darker. And then the corners of things. Actually, let me get these angles up here on the top part. Or I guess they're this piece. You know, if this thing was outdoors, you know, there'd be dirt flying everywhere and this thing would get pretty dirty. But it also erodes from, you know, the wind blowing the dirt. And the weakest points on things is usually the edges. And so it chips away pieces and then exposes new material, if that makes any sense. So I usually use that, you know, to pull. You know, I'll make these corners lighter and stuff. You'll see what I mean. Actually, I'm going to use a soft brush for this. So it'll be the edges of that. I think I'm going to do the same thing with the So something like that, and I'll do these two. Yeah, I just want to pull out them edges a bit. And then I'm going to use a new tool, which is the line. Oh, if it'll let me. The hotkey didn't seem to be working. I'm going to do this in the UV image editor, I think. And I'm just going to kind of sketch in the bricks. I don't know if there's a way to was not anything I tried, but Blender hotkeys tend to not be anything that I try. It kinda just does its own thing. I don't want these to be perfectly even or anything. We'll do a bigger brick right here. Just to break the pattern a little bit. That's going to be a problem, isn't it? The way I unwrap this is working against me. I'll just do that. I don't like that. Again, I'm not even trying to be perfect here. I think it's okay. And I think I'll split this concrete slab, at least the bottom one. I don't know. I think I'll leave the top one. So I think it'll be too difficult with the way I unwrap this to do much with that anyway. Let's see. I want this to be in the center. I can use that 3D cursor probably as a makeshift guide. Something like that. That way it looks like four stones for the base. So let's just do some color variation stuff. A lot of people, it's a style choice. A lot of people will do, you know, their habits is I'll do a blue, and then down in the shadows it'll be a dark blue, and then in the highlights it'll be a light blue. I tend to go for more analogous color schemes, I guess. And analogous means on a color wheel, the colors are close to each other. It happens in nature a lot. If you see, like, grass, the grass will be green, but the highlights on the grass will be, like, a more yellow-green, and then the shadows will be more of a blue-green. It's because the direct light is getting hit by the sun, so it's a warmer color. The shadows is from the reflection of the blue sky. And I usually try to do that. I vary it even more sometimes, just, you know, experimentally. I'll just start throwing reds and stuff in there. I don't know if I'm going to do that in this demo or not. Maybe. So to do that, you know, you just don't really be too careful. But I want to just, you know, start dabbing in some colors here. Oh, I'm on a line. No wonder it's so screwy. Let's try this again. Maybe get some more greenish blues in there. And there's a property of colors that is, it's all relative. If I do a gray, since I'm on a blue, if I just go straight gray, no color at all, and put it on this blue, it's going to look almost like it has warmth in it, almost like it's like this. It really does have some color into it. Even though it doesn't, it's pure gray. On the other hand, if you put it on a warm color, it almost looks like it has blue in it. And every color will do that, but it's easiest to see with gray. So sometimes I will just, you know, start dabbing little blotches of gray in there. It seems counterintuitive, but just adding gray can actually add color variation, because you get warmth without actually adding the complementary color to whatever you're painting on. So I'm just dabbing around here. This will make more sense later on why I'm doing this. I'm just trying to get color variation in there. I'm not really trying to paint the bricks. I'll come back and blend these, but you know, for now I'm trying to generate happy accidents, basically. actually use texture brushes. I'm just, keeping it simple and sticking to round. It's there's a tendency for a lot of people they focus more on the brushes than the actual art aspect in digital, at least. Back when I was on gouache, nobody ever asked me what kind of brush I use, but in digital, it's always, oh, if I just had his brush, I could paint just like him, which, it's not really how it works. But having a texture on it can speed things up quite a bit. So I'm going to go ahead and start blending these in. I'm actually going to blend them mostly with this hard brush. And to do that, I just color pick what's there and then kind of smear it around a bit and try to make it work. And I'm paying attention to the value. Color you can kind of do whatever you want with, but value it'll look really wrong if you don't do it correctly. And value is just how dark or light a color is, if you didn't know that. Color is almost like an illusion. Different animals see different amounts of color, and even between humans, some are colorblind, and I've read that some women in the population can actually see more colors than the average human can. Apologies for these gaps in the commentary. It's kind of hard to draw and talk at the same time. I'm not used to it. Normally, I just throw on a podcast or something and just paint away, but it's actually kind of interesting how difficult this is to do. I paint all the time, so most of the stuff going through my head as I'm doing this is really routine, but needing to actually speak it out loud kind of makes me second guess myself a bit, and it's difficult. People who do this stuff, props to you, because a lot of you guys make it look a lot easier than I think it really is. I'm probably going to lose a lot of that gradation that I had at the beginning, and that's okay. It was mainly there to give me a starting point. I can always add it back at the end if I want it. It's a thing in art. The most daunting thing is a blank sheet of paper, right? So the easiest thing I find is just to get rid of that as quick as you can. It doesn't even really matter how. I could have painted this any color I wanted at the beginning. I'm not too concerned at this point if I lose that initial sketch that I had. By the end of it, the lines are too perfect, and I don't want to keep it that way. I don't want to say it's not realistic, but I don't find it interesting, I guess. Oops. That's something you have to be careful of with projection paint. Sometimes I do that and I don't notice it until a lot later and get myself in a bit of trouble. Oh, and this is the color palette. I didn't show that. I don't usually use that. What happens is if you hover and have the color picker selected, which is S, and then you click, it'll add the colors to that. In most image editors, the way you color pick is you hold down a button, is usually Control or Alt, and then you click on something to pick the color. In this case, you just have to hover. And I'm not used to that, so oftentimes I'll have like 20 colors by the end I'm painting in this color palette that I didn't even intend to do. It's just kind of a control thing that I'm not used to. But it's all right, it doesn't really hurt anything. And I do sometimes use that color palette for things. So I'm kind of emphasizing these lines and things in here. by the end of it, it's going to look, make that look like dirt, the way I'm going to blend it in. And you could use a soft brush if you wanted for stuff like this, because this is all, when I get into the tighter detail, this will all come together and it'll look okay. Right now it just looks like crap, but it's just the way it starts. This is kind of like the reason I work on the whole thing at once is it's like I could technically stop here. It doesn't look very good, but you know, everything is technically done, but from here I can just spend hours and hours just refining it until it looks really good. Whereas if I just had done this one brick and taken it all the way to full, then I'd have to do it again and again and again and again. It just seems more daunting, and then on top of that, like this one will wind up being like by the time you get up to this brick, you've got new techniques that you've figured out. You're all nice and warmed up, and this one will start looking kind of crappy, and then you'll want to go back and just redo that, and it becomes kind of like an infinite loop. Whereas if you just do the whole thing at once, everything's going to be a lot more even. I think I'm going to warm up the cracks just a bit. You know, just put a little bit of orange in there. The idea is kind of, you know, the dirt gets clung in here and water washes down, it doesn't quite get it out, and, you know, just things like that. A lot of this is, there's going to be a little bit of a cast shadow. You can't do too dramatic of lighting on this stuff, but you can do some. A lot of these little differences in color variation and slight value changes, in the end, I'm gonna, you know, pick and pull little highlights here and there, and it'll be kind of like happy accidents that turn into extra surface detail. I think it's starting to come together. Looks less like splotches of paint, more like solid objects, at least. show you how the detail and stuff like that works, and then I'm probably gonna cut and then kind of come back and show you at the end and maybe explain a few more things. So there's not really any reason, like if I just do one of these, there's not really any reason to go, and paint all of them, because it's the same principles over and over again. But the tighter detail you do, I'm just making a little crack here. The tighter detail you do, the sharper your image becomes. So if I just do a crack here and I'm gonna really pull in, make some really detail this thing. And you can just do easy, it's easy enough. You can even just do dots and things. Just knock little chunks out of the corners. Maybe we'll add a crack over here too. Maybe I'll chisel this whole corner down quite a bit. But you just chisel it off and then throw in some highlights to pull that detail back out, I guess. And another thing you can do, I mean, some of this just gets into, fundamentals of painting, which are a bit, a little broad for just a little single painting demo. Maybe I'll continue doing these and fill in on some of that stuff, but so I want this edge, I really want to pull it out. But it's not a clean edge, it's been eroded. So the lighting on it isn't going to be perfect. Another thing I sometimes do is you can if you put a fairly dark tone right next to these highlights, they'll really pop. It's, contrast or whatever really pulls in the or pulls attention, I should say. I'm just gonna do basic. I'll do both these bricks, I guess. And then I'm gonna pause the video, paint, do all the detailing kind of off camera, and then come back and maybe, explain some things I did if necessary. I don't. But it's because this is basically the same thing over and over again, just for each brick. But you can see that just pulling in them highlights and putting in little cracks and things really brings it all together, where it doesn't look like random scribbles like this stuff does. It starts to look like a kind of a polished face, but with a lot of color variation in it. So something like that, it starts off really bold and looks awkward, but if you zoom out and you take it into, in the full context of things or whatever, it'll fade, and not draw as much attention to itself. But I think, stuff like that, it adds a lot of life to the thing, I think. I don't want to go too crazy with the cracks and make this thing look shattered or something where, that just wouldn't work. But at the same time, I do find that kind of stuff really fun to paint. I just have to err on the being a bit conservative if I can. You can see it doesn't take much to really find stuff like that really, really fun to paint, and it really it adds a lot of character, I think, to stuff like this when you can put things like that in. And then also with the brush strokes, just a second here. When you get these, you got all these varied brush strokes and stuff. Let me make a couple just slightly darker. You get some little slightly darker things like that. If you take just a little bit lighter thing, a lighter shade, you just kind of really lightly do that, it'll look like even more detail on the stone. Kind of like a chunk flaked off a bit. Let me do some on this one too. Kind of abstract shape in there from just from brush strokes, totally accidental. I mean, I didn't intend to get any particular shape. And you just really lightly. These are too dark. Then it starts to feel, it feels like little pieces maybe chipped off, like big flat chunks. Anyway, when you get around to this point, it's just putting in more time and refining details over and over again. You could kind of just go on forever at this point. So what I'm gonna do is, go ahead and cut this, finish it off, then come back, talk a bit about it, and call this video done, I think. 'Cause there's just no reason to watch me meticulously detail this thing for another 2 hours or whatever it'll take. So yeah, be back in a sec. All right, sorry for cutting so much of this. I know that's gonna bother some people, but I don't want this to drag on forever. Hopefully at this point though, there's not too much mystery in how, the rest of these were done. It is the same technique I showed repeated over and over again. I didn't change brushes or anything like that. It's if I zoom in and just analyze this one block, you can see, well, I got some orange color in there. It looks like a little purple, some blue green, and some gray, and then I just pulled out highlights and, maybe put in a little bit of shadow. Same story for every block. It's, time and practice is all you really need if you're not used to painting to get to this point. Another thing I should talk about is when I do like cracks and dirt, I try to ground that kind of stuff in reality a bit, if that makes sense. Like this bottom piece you can see is pretty dirty and worn down and damaged compared to this top piece, which it still has dirt and damage, but just not to the severity of this bottom part. And that's just, it's basically because this is lower to the ground, more dirt's going to accumulate down here, be likely to be up here and damage this as much. I just try to keep that stuff in the back of my mind. It's not anything that anybody notices, but I feel that it gives my worlds a bit more authenticity than they otherwise would have. Even if they're highly stylized, it works out that way, which, you know, most of my stuff tends to be pretty stylized. But yeah, I think the last thing I'm going to do, I'm going to add that a bit of that gradient back that I had that I've kind of lost. I'm just going to use this masking tool. If you've never used this, you know, just turn it on, and then all it's doing is whatever you have selected in edit mode, whatever faces, I should say, is what it's going to limit you to paint on. Easy enough. And I'm just going to use that with the fill tool. I was messing with this earlier, and it seems the gradient doesn't work with blend modes. Like, normally I would do it like a black to white and just turn on multiply, which will cancel out the white, and then paint it on here, and I'll just get like a darker transition down here to nothing. But blend modes don't seem to be working. So the workaround is I'm just going to go black to black, but then turn down this alpha on one end. It'll give me the same effect. It's just a different way to do it. Let's see, I need to turn strength all the way down. And I just want this to be pretty subtle. Yeah, that's fine. You can see that, you know, it's not anything that I would want anybody to notice necessarily, but it just kind of indicates that there's a little more light up here than there is down here, and that just kind of gives it a bit more depth. That's all. But yeah, I think that's going to do it. I'll try to upload this model somewhere in case anybody wants